Please stand for our opening prayer and pledge with Dr. David Heck from First Baptist Church, followed by the pledge with, led by General McQueen.
Good morning. May we pray together? Dear Heavenly Father, we humbly and joyfully come before you this day, acknowledging you as our Creator and Sovereign. We ask for your wisdom, guidance, strength, and blessing upon our Panama City Commission meeting, upon our Mayor, Greg Brudnicki, and upon our City Commissioners, Jenna Flint Halligas, Mike Nichols, Billy Rader, and Kenneth Brown, upon our City Manager, Mark McQueen, and upon all of our Panama City officials and staff, and upon all those who are gathered here today to discuss issues, consider proposals, allocate resources, and to make decisions for the well-being of our citizens and for the maintenance and the development of our community. We thank you for our citizens. We thank you for the community in which we live and serve, the resources that you have provided for us, and for the sacrifice that is made by each of our public officials and by their families as they serve the citizens of Panama City. Guard and protect us from those forces that seek to kill, steal, and destroy us. Help us to work together in the unity of peace and the bond of community. Lead and empower us, Father, to reach our full potential for the well-being and quality of life for every citizen and for every segment of our community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are you okay, Jane? Jane, would you call the roll, please, ma'am?
Mayor Brudnicki.
Here.
Commissioner Brown.
Here.
Commissioner Rader.
Here.
Commissioner Nichols.
Here.
Commissioner Halligas.
Here.
We have the minutes from the City Commission meeting from July the 14th and also the minutes from the Audit Committee meeting on July 15th. Any additions or deletions to those minutes? If everyone's satisfied with what has been printed, I'd like a motion to accept both of those as presented.
Yes, Mayor. I'll make the motion to approve the minutes from the City Commission meeting of July the 14th, 2020, and the minutes from the Audit Committee virtual meeting held on July 15th, 2020, both of those.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halligas?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Yes, ma'am. We're going to have an addition, a 6G. Budget discussion regarding fire assessments. I'd like to add that to the agenda, please. So can I get a vote to add addendum one to the agenda?
Yes, I'll move approval to add,
addendum one.
Addendum one to item 6G. Put that as 6G in the City Commission agenda today.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halligas?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Yes. I'd like to call on Commissioner Brown. He wanted to have the floor for a moment.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Last week, I had an opportunity to recognize a great and outstanding person with a proclamation from the city of Panama City, Florida. It was beyond my control, but it did not happen. Nope. Proclamation. At this time, I would like to say to Mother Jimmy Lee Miller, who was born on July the 23rd, 1920, celebrated her 100th birthday this past July the 23rd, 2020. I think it is fitting and proper to now present this proclamation. Therefore, I, Kenneth Brown, Commissioner of Ward 2, Panama City, Florida, by virtue of the authority invested in me, I do hereby proclaim July the 23rd, 2020, as Mother Jimmy Lee Miller's belated day throughout the city of Panama City, Florida. Mother Miller, if you are listening, and I hope you get this on the telecast, for I will be personally make sure you and your family receive your copy of this proclamation. I am wishing you many, many more happy birthdays to come. Thank you for being who you are.
About that.
And I would like to thank Dr. Woods for bringing this person to us.
Very good. Okay, at this time we'll have audience participation. If there's something that's not on the agenda today that you'd like to bring before the commission, do so at this time.
Morning, Derek Thomas, 1100 West 10th Street. I came here about 5 years ago, and I've been having problems with the drainage in my neighborhood. Back in 53, there was an easement granted to the city to handle the drainage on the lot directly east of me. It was only supposed to be maintained for 6 months, but it said in the easement that the city would come up with a way to address the runoff. They did that. There was a low-lying area. It was like a big giant bowl in between what is an artesian well and the drain. The drain is the low part of the drain facing in towards the block. Is the only drain facing in towards the block, and it's about 4 feet below the height of the road. That was cemented shut, and the owner had said that the water was coming out of the drain onto their property. The bowl part was filled in, and now it's more or less flat. The artesian well is still there, but my neighbor's property is now turned into a retention pond, and the height of the water table in my neighborhood has gone up by several feet, creating flooding on my property, on my neighbor's property. Lots of people in the neighborhood have complained about it, but it has not been addressed by the city. I've been trying for 5 years just to get the city to make a good faith effort to put right the damage they helped cause. The person sold the property for $59,000 more than it was worth, and within a year and a half, it had been reduced down $69,000 below what the price it had sold at. Still, it's changed hands again, and I cannot get the city to either take care of the ditch, the drain that faces the lot, which is only just a narrow, less than 10 inches in places, and filled up with grass in between the artesian well and that. It used to be that the water could move from there directly into it. There was nothing in that person's yard but pine trees up to that point, and then that guy's backyard was nothing but elephant ears. Now there's several different kinds of plants that only grow when they're standing water year-round, like cattails and other plants that had never been there up until 5 years ago. It's actually only been over the last couple of years that they're starting to grow there. The ditch in my block has not been really maintained either. It's almost completely filled in. If the city does anything, they just come by with a weed eater and knock the plants down into the bottom of the ditch. It fills it up even more. The drainage, I don't see why that should be such an issue. I've tried bringing it up to code enforcement. They say it's up to code enforcement who they enforce the codes on and who they don't. The new code enforcement rules say that they have public groups and organizations that will provide input into who code enforcement goes after and who they don't. I'd like those groups to be named. I'd also like there to be some accountability. If the last time I came up here when you were selling the marina and objected to the suggestion that it was going to be careers. I used to work at SMG. I know somebody that worked there for 21 years, worked every single show, and they were still getting paid the same amount that they were getting paid when they started, with no benefits. And I noticed that this last charrette that you had, that there was a group of people who split up and one to every single table, they were all employees of the St. Joe Development Corporation. I think if you're going to do that instead of fixing the drainage in my neighborhood, you should allow the public to vote whether or not they want to be giving away that land instead of maintaining the ditches or doing something to that extent. Thank you.
Okay. Can we have someone just take a look at the, Ms. Proctor over there? All right, thank you. Anyone else? Okay, we'll move on. Nevin?
Thank you. The first item that we have is ratification of extension of declaration of state emergency due to Hurricane Michael. I appreciate a vote to approve that ratification.
Your motion on 6A?
I'd like to move approval of item 6A, Mayor.
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Second is ratification for the next state of emergency, COVID-19. A vote to approve that ratification.
Your motion on extension 18?
Yes, Mayor, I'd like to make that motion for approval.
Your second?
Second.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Next item is an announcement of an executive session taking place at the end of the county city commission meeting. We'll meet pursuant to section 286.011 Florida statutes, an attorney-client executive session to discuss the case of St. Andrews Civic Club versus City of Panama City. And at that time, I will announce those who will be attending. This will be take place right before the conclusion of the meeting. The meeting will not be adjourned, but there is a executive session room upstairs that we'll adjourn to. Court reporter will be present to discuss and for you to give Mr. Higby and I advice as to the ongoing litigation with the St. Andrews Civic Club. At the conclusion of the executive session, no votes will be taken at the executive session. This commission will come back downstairs and conclude the meeting. If there is to be a vote taken, you can take one at that time. If there is no vote, then the meeting would be adjourned. But those in attendance will be the five city commissioners, Mr. McQueen, your city manager, Cliff Higby, and me as your attorneys, and possibly Mike Burke. And Mike Burke will be here.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you.
The next item I have is approval of a purchase agreement with AmeriGas Propane. This is a parcel of property that is located in Millville, adjacent to the Watson Park there in Millville. The purchase price is less than the assessed value on the property appraiser's website. It's $299,000. There's been a phase one and a phase two. Phase two has been examined by city staff. See no issues with the phase two. And that they, for the intended use as a park, the little area that was spotted is actually near the boundary of the property, close to the old railroad tracks, and would not be a factor in the use of the park. But it does not require any mitigation. The closing date is sometime before September 3rd, and title is good, and all closing costs are paid for by the seller. Charlie Haas is here. If there are any questions, he is the realtor representing the seller, but the recommendation is to ratify the contract. It was signed by the city manager. It is subject to ratification during the due diligence period.
Your motion?
Motion to approve purchase of property in Millville. It's a great addition for the quality of life for our city.
Okay. Of course, I'll second that, but I do just want to say that, you know, we've gotten rid of some properties that we didn't think were quality. This will be an extension of the already existing Millville Waterfront Park. Right now, if it's industrial, obviously it'll be zoned to recreation and just part of the bigger vision of more waterfront for the citizens.
And, Commissioner Halagus, I'd like to just add one thing, because sometimes I'll wake up and I'm reminiscing, or, you know, not dreaming, reminiscing. And I remember so well when we purchased the park from and the property from Tico Gas. I think that was back around 2009 or something. And this vision is becoming a reality. And so this is just a great extension to that.
And obviously, hopefully we'll get to a point we can decommission the Millville treatment that we have there, yep. And then we'd have quite a waterfront park over there. So that's a long-term goal.
I just wanted to share that with you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
All I have.
Any other discussion? Call roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
Next item is a recommendation to adopt a resolution that approves the mutual aid agreement with the Sheriff's Department.
Move approval of item 6E. Sorry, Mayor, were you going to ask?
No, that's fine. Motion. You're a second.
Okay.
Yes, second the motion.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes. Nevin?
Resolution number 2200728.2, a resolution of the City of Panama City, Florida, providing for Panama City Police Department to enter into an operational assistance agreement with the Bay County Sheriff's Office. Next item is a discussion of the body-altering establishment ordinance. I have presented to the commissioners a letter, and in that letter, it goes through a variety of things, which I'll briefly go over with the commissioners. First, excuse me, I prepared another draft of the ordinance based upon the last discussion, just to talk about what's in front of you. Is that there's a definition of gateway overlay district, which is as already defined in your Panama City Code. Then there's a definition of gateway overlay roadways, and then there's tourism corridors. First, there is a removal of the space limitation between churches and tattoo parlors or body-altering establishments. So the strike-through language struck through the definition of church, struck through the prohibition of no nearer than 1,000 feet from any church. The second thing is that there is language here as far as a prohibition on tourism corridors. And it uses language that was in the sexual, that is in the sexually oriented business ordinance that says that sexually oriented businesses cannot be located nearer than 200 feet to the nearest right-of-way line of any tourism corridor. So that same distance, the language is the distance test, is picked up and placed in there as far as the prohibition of tattoo parlors no nearer than 250 feet from the nearest right-of-way line of any tourism corridor. As it comes to gateway overlays, and there is an overlap between the two, not completely, but there is an overlap. The gateway overlay is actually 400 feet on either side of the right-of-way. So it just says no tattoo parlors within the gateway overlay. And then in each of those, there is a carve-out or an exception for those tattoo parlors that may be in the downtown entertainment district. And that is the historic downtown entertainment district is an area defined by special act of the city of the state legislature that was adopted a few years ago. And in the historic downtown entertainment district, you can be closer than 250 feet provided that the primary and public entrance to the body altering business is on a road or street that is not a tourism corridor. So it can be closer than 250 feet, but it has to have a public entrance that's not on the tourism corridor or within a road that's within the gateway overlay. So that's the changes to the ordinance. The other thing I pointed out in the letter is that when it comes to actually prohibiting tattoo parlors then the city commission needs to have some evidence entered into the record at the time that is done. The evidence is typically a demonstration of the negative economic impacts that a tattoo parlor would have on the surrounding area or on tourism or some legitimate governmental purpose that is furthered by prohibiting them on a specific location such as the tourism corridor. You cannot prohibit them everywhere. It's a lawful business. You can do things like you've already done, which is have separation, buffering requirements between tattoo parlors, between tattoo parlor and church. But when it comes to actually saying no tattoo parlors on a tourism corridor, then there needs to be a predicate laid at the public hearing on how that has a negative impact on the community. And it can't just be your notion of it. There needs to be, we've done some Google search and have found a few things, but it's not, we don't have that to present to you. If you want to move forward in that direction, then that is something that the city staff would need to assist you in providing and finding where that could be obtained. So that is an overview. If there does not need to be a first reading at all, there has not been a public hearing on it. I know that one attorney is here to address the commission at one point when that's appropriate, but I'm open to answer any questions.
Well, if the commission would, I think I'd like to have public discussion before we talk and we have people come up and give their opinions, and then we can have our discussion. So if you would like to address the commission, do so at this time. Give your name and your address, and you'll have 3 minutes.
Excuse me.
Evan, if I may approve.
Sure.
Morning.
Hey, good morning.
Thank you.
Thank you, buddy.
Thank you, Mr. Henry.
Mercy.
Good morning. My name is Michael Henry. I'm from the law firm of Dunlop and Shipman, and I'm here this morning on behalf of my client, Steve Thomas, of Electrolux Tattoo Company. Since my time is short this morning, I've given you a packet of materials that I believe will be instructive and helpful as we talk about the body altering ordinance. As Attorney Zimmerman stated, to enact an ordinance that would regulate the time, location, and manner of a protected First Amendment activity, the art of tattooing, there needs to be pre-enactment evidence that this would support an important governmental interest. It's been suggested that regulating tattooing on the tourism corridor or the gateway overlay zone would somehow benefit tourism. In the packet that you have before you is some articles about tattoo tourism. It's a multi-million, it's a multi-million dollar industry, and people will travel to a location to get a tattoo from a renowned artist or a skilled artist. They'll also come to an area for the culture and the art. They're going to spend tourism money to do the tattooing. What's important also in the packet are three federal court cases that were all decided within the past 5 years. The cases stand for the proposition that if you're going to regulate the location of a protected First Amendment activity such as tattooing, you need to tie that to the governmental interest. The City of Burley versus Key West case was presented by Mr. Thomas at the last meeting. More important in that packet is the case of Yvonne versus the City of Oceanside. Oceanside tried to regulate where tattoo parlors could be. The only evidence that they had prior to the enactment was studies about sexually oriented businesses. This commission has stated that tattooing has nothing to do with sexually oriented businesses. If you look in the packet in 2005, when the original ordinance was enacted, The only evidence put in the record was case law, studies, and ordinances from other jurisdictions that dealt with sexually oriented businesses. At the time, public comment, three citizens stated, "We're not sure how this relates." Mayor Clemens and Commissioner Wilson also made that same comment. That's in the record there. We believe that the reduction of the distance between tattoo establishments and churches is supported. Commissioner Rader, you stated at the last meeting that you hadn't received any feedback from the religious community. This commission had also reduced the restriction between the distance between schools and parks and tattoo establishments last year. Again, we believe that tattooing will benefit tourism. It's not going to hurt it. It's going to enhance the area. Therefore, we ask that you move forward with amending the ordinance to reduce the restriction on churches to zero, as you have discussed, but also not to move forward with the ordinance as written, because this would be an impermissible overreach restricting.
Thank you, First Mr. Henry.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay. Commissioners, who would like to start?
Yeah, I'll start this week. So, you know, every 2 weeks we get presented with different information and different facts or different philosophies. So for me, and speaking on my behalf, this is, and we talk about the tourist corridor, this is larger than tattoo parlors, strip clubs, whatever it may be. This is how a visitor to our city that's going to stay in one of our hotels, how do they see our city? So that's how we do our planning, our zoning, what kind of buildings we put on a corridor. So it's just not about a tattoo parlor. So for me, it's not about a tattoo parlor. That's what's in front of us today. And so over the last month and a half, every meeting, something has changed. Something in this ordinance has changed. We heard testimony from a gentleman out of Lynn Haven that their ordinance is stricter than ours. So, you know, I kind of get confused. And what Mr. Henry said, and I agree with, is that when somebody's looking for a tattoo, they're going to seek out that artist that's best. And it doesn't matter where they're located at. They're going to find that artist, and they're going to go to that artist for that tattoo, because it is a piece of art. And I agree with that. I watch ink on TV. So it doesn't have to be on a corridor. It could be somewhere. So with that, what I want to recommend to this commission, because we get so much stuff, and what Mr. Zimmerman had just said is that, and what Mr. Henry also said, is that we as a government has to say, how does it affect us? And so with that, and when we meet in a commission meeting, we talk about multiple things, multiple subjects, and we're not focusing on what's in front of us. I think that I want to recommend that we do a workshop and focus just on tattoo parlors, on how they affect our city as a whole, not just tourism, not just downtown, but as a whole. How do we implement what type of buildings we have, and have that conversation in a workshop, and we could focus just particularly on this issue or this ordinance that's in front of us today. So that's going to be my recommendation moving forward, because we get bits and pieces and this doesn't work, and we want to apply this for this particular area, or we want to change this zone. When I hear testimony, it's stricter in other places, maybe county, maybe the beach, maybe in Lynn Haven, then hey, let's put it all together and say, what do we want for city of Panama City and the citizens that live in our city?
Okay, who's next?
Nate, on what he said. Go ahead. You go.
Oh, well, you know, sometimes I agree with Mr. Nichols.
Not often.
I will do this, and this has gotten confusing, and we have adjusted things and we've changed things. But I don't know how long it's going to take to get this done. So I would like to lift, if there's someone that wants to follow the ordinance that we have in place right now, and go open the business, let them do it. I mean, I don't want to see us, until we get all this worked out, oh, nobody can apply for a license. No. I would agree with you, but I would agree that we have an ordinance in place, and as long as people follow what's in place and they want to go open somewhere, we should not restrict it until we get through figuring out what we want to be or where we want to have things. So
yeah,
that's the only thing that I want to add to what you said is that I think that we need to we've got people out there. We don't want to be have restraint of trade. If someone wants to comply with the ordinance that we've got, do it and go in business.
I talked to Nevin about this as well, just like I'm sure we all have, but I do think it's going to be difficult. I'm not against doing a workshop at all. That's probably a great idea. I hadn't thought about that, but I guess sometimes I feel like this is a really big deal, like talking about a workshop, and then other times I'm like, this is really not a big deal and it should be simple. But after talking to Nevin, I think the workshop would have to be necessary from a citywide change because of, I think it would be difficult, I think, to prove that it has the same effect basically as a strip club does on a church. And we would have to do it from a legal perspective, we would have to prove that. So that probably would be good. But I think that it can also be simple in the sense that maybe we just keep the ordinance the same across the city, except for the downtown district, and not change anything except the distance from churches. I mean, having no church problem and keeping the distance between tattoo parlors and just dropping the, I mean, I have no problem with that at all because it's still 1,000 feet from tattoo parlor. Tattoo parlor is still pretty big distance, but it will allow maybe one or two that aren't able to exist right now. Yeah, because it's so compact. And it is an arts district, and it's, you know, I have definitely, you know, looked at our visioning plan about that and art and public art and all kinds of different art of the visioning process downtown. I mean, I'm not advocating. I mean, I went through a particular city this last week that I was like, wow. I mean, it was a whole corridor, which is kind of cool for a tattoo corridor, but it was a downtown. And so I was like, I think that if it has the distance between the two, like we already have, so basically everything the same everywhere else, except maybe the downtown district. And I don't mean the distance between, just the church distance.
Okay, so you want to talk about that in a workshop?
Do I?
That's what I'm asking.
Oh, well, does anyone have a problem with that up here? What are your thoughts on that, Mike or Billy or, yeah?
I haven't spoken yet. I would like to, I think a workshop is a tremendous idea. I like that idea, and I also like what the mayor said. If we have an ordinance that's in place, if someone meets that criteria that's already written down in black and white, there's no gray area. If they meet that criteria and they go apply for a business license, let them do it. Let them do it. If we need, but with that being said, that's what he said. I would agree with that. But I do think we need to look at a district I've seen that in other cities too, and I think that's a great point. But I don't think we can do it all in one day. See, that's what I'm trying to say here. But we have something that's in place, and if somebody, I don't want to slow anybody down, but I honestly have not had any feedback from churches. You're right, but I haven't had any negative feedback from that. So with that being said, we are being fed a lot of information every single meeting, and that's because it's due diligence. It's due diligence, folks, and that's all I can say. We want to get it right. If it's worth doing, it's worth doing right. I've always believed that. So
right now, go ahead.
Mayor, just listen to everyone up here now, which normally we are not adamant about doing that because we want to keep everything. But from what I'm hearing so far, I like the idea of keeping everything the same for right now. And even the downtown, just like it is, until we go for the workshop. When we go to the workshop, personally, I'm going to learn a lot. We don't have to worry about speeding it and doing things. Now, we still got lots of time.
Right
Now, yes, I'm going to go with what everybody's saying here, because I'm getting feeling from everyone by the words and the conversation that we're having. So I don't think we will not go wrong by waiting, put a little bit more time between this, and I'll come up with something later as a workshop.
Okay, so Nevin, is there an issue with us lifting this restriction now that...
No.
Okay, so someone wants to comply with what we've got in place now, they can go do it.
What pending ordinance, the notion there, and what the instruction from the city manager and my advice to him and the commission is that with the pending ordinance, which may not be pending in a few minutes, but with the pending ordinance, if you comply with the existing ordinance, then you can open up shop. There's never been a ban on opening up a tattoo parlor, but you have to comply with the existing ordinance. That's the first. Then the second, though, is that if, for example, you complied, but it was on the tourism corridor, then there's this pending ordinance that would ban them from the tourism corridors, and that application would be stopped. What I hear, possibly, is that the commissioners want to say, let's don't worry about the pending ordinance, let's just drop that. So if somebody wants to open up a place on the tourism corridor, if it meets the spacing, the 1,000 feet spacing requirement, then they can do so. Is that what I hear from the commission?
Well, that's for sure. Let people go ahead and open their business.
All right.
What would be useful, I think, for staff would be a
motion that actually says that
there is presently, we're going to ask for a workshop, and there is no pending ordinance at this time. And then once we have the workshop, and if there's a direction at that time, there could be.
So the only question I have is, so what is, besides kicking the can down, what is the workshop really going to put? What information will we gain from that? Except, are you talking about citizen feedback? Or are we talking about, like, what are we going to gain? What information will we gain with that?
Yeah, let me just say why I recommended it. And I'm reading the stuff that he presented to us on each one of those cases. Is that based on what I heard from Mr. Zimmerman, based on what we had talked about the last commission meeting about corridors and distances and et cetera, and this is not the last 45 days. We've talked about this probably for the last couple of years.
Yeah.
And so the best way of doing it, instead of just keep talking about it, changing it, moving this one, let's get in and let's do it right based on law. So if there's some precedents in terms of lawsuits that are out there that we have to abide by, then let's look at that legally. You know, there's two ways of doing it. Do what we're doing, and they sue us, and let's go to court, and let's the courts figure it out.
No, I don't want to do that.
Or let's do a workshop, and let's figure out exactly what those rules and laws are going to be, and let's implement it. So when I say a workshop, I'm not pushing it down the road. It's just we should have done this 45 days ago on the subject, because we have talked about it in the past. Within the next 2 weeks, we should have a workshop. Next week, we should have a workshop. And then get the stuff presented to us on what we can, can't do, and not just looking at adult entertainment business, but maybe overall in that conversation, if we're talking about the gateways and the tourist corridors.
So, yeah, I guess I see two different things. I see like a citywide one, and then I see kind of how we did bars and liquor in the downtown district, where it didn't affect anywhere else in the city except for the downtown district. I guess what I want to know from up here is, does anyone have any feeling about not wanting to drop the church distance downtown? That's what I guess I'm trying to get at, because that's a much more, I'm just trying to figure out if this is something like, I mean, how do you feel, Mayor?
Well, we have an ordinance in place. I really, when we start bringing all this illegality and legality involved, I don't want to make a quick decision to do something and then turn around and say, well, you know, you can't prove that having a particular business on a particular road is going to be detrimental to the rest of the places around there. And so then we open ourselves up for a a silly lawsuit, a frivolous lawsuit, but regardless, an expensive lawsuit. So I want to weigh all of those things based on what Mr. Henry dropped off over here and look at that and say, you know what? Maybe what we've got is what we need. Maybe we just need to tweak one thing. Maybe it only needs to be in one particular area, but let's talk about it. And let's address them all, whether, you know, with Glenwood, with Millville, when with and with St. Andrews.
Right, because I'm not for the legal part either. I realize we need time for that. I was just wondering your thoughts and feelings on just the the downtown district. But you don't want a car. You don't want that to be separate.
No.
Okay.
I don't think so.
Not yet.
I'm not in favor. I'm not in favor of changing the churches today. Okay. I said I have not had any feedback, negative feedback. Okay. But so as that being said, we have the ordinance in place. I think it should be status quo today. But let's do the workshop. Let's put our heads together in a relaxed atmosphere where we can roll up our sleeves a little bit and, you know, look at pictures, diagrams, slideshow, whatever that helps us understand and you know, and to grasp it.
So who will bring us this information to the workshop?
This is good. Staff will put it together.
It would be staff.
Just some information. I believe Commissioner Nichols indicated it was even a bigger picture. So I think information about the gateway corridors and what is and isn't allowed and design standards and things like that, just for information, would be interesting at the workshop. Then as it applies to two parlors, obviously a review of the case law, a review of other jurisdictions, how they regulate tattoo parlors. We have approached this every meeting at a very focused point. So it might be interesting to see what is the law in Lynn Haven and Panama City Beach or Fort Walton or wherever. So that would be interesting information as well. And then a review of any studies in the literature is from tattoo parlors.
That or the positive impact.
Or positive,
whatever, whatever it is. And those are just some things I can think of. And then obviously you'll be giving us feedback as well. And
will the public be involved in that? I just don't think we've ever done one, so I'm just trying to figure out what.
Yeah, absolutely. They would be.
But would it be like similar to our goal sessions?
Yep,
yeah.
Exactly.
Goal public, yeah. Public meeting.
Yeah.
That's a direction. It would be useful to have a motion to set one within the next 45 days
to go over those items, and then
also indicate that a motion to set a public workshop, and at this time there is no pending ordinance that the commissioners are considering. In other words, you'll pick that back up at the conclusion of your deliberations at a workshop.
Hey, do I hear a motion that we have a public workshop in the next 45 days?
We do it sooner than that to start the process.
How much time do you need to gather your information, Mr. Zimmerman?
30 days? Yeah, I mean, so.
Preferably sooner than later.
Absolutely.
Yeah, within 45 days. We'll try to do it sooner.
But then that means then we have to have a decision and then we got to come back. So it's just the painful part of government. So, and I just know there's a lot of people who are wanting to get going whatever way it is. And I just want to put an end to this. So, okay.
All right.
Do I understand we would shoot for under 30 or in that ballpark? Yeah. And
okay.
Goodness gracious. I want to applaud staff because we have directed you. We have given you things, and you've done a tremendous job. But it's overwhelming.
A lot more other things.
There is a lot more to this than we thought. And I'd say that with all due respect.
Okay. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Okay, any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagas?
Are we voting yes for a workshop?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Mayor Bernicke.
Yes.
Commissioners, I interpret then your motion and vote is that today there's no pending ordinance. And that so the ordinance as written will be enforced.
And that was a statement that the mayor said, yes.
Yes.
Next item.
Mr. Zimmerman, I think he wants to ask a question. Is that appropriate? I mean, is it okay? I mean, I'm sorry, Mayor.
Go ahead. I didn't see.
Michael Henry again. With the pending ordinance off the table at this time and the current one in place, is the city open to requests for variances from the ordinance?
No.
Thank you for that clarification.
Next item is item 6G. There is, this has to do with the budget, and I know that there is a memo that is attached from City Manager McQueen that talks about the need, the financial need of the city to have a different tool available as far as revenue. Already Panama City is diversified in its revenue, which is very fortunate. Not only do you have property taxes, and other cities also get state revenue sharing and gas taxes, but Panama City and Panama City Beach are the only two cities that have a merchant tax, and that allows you to be diversified in your revenue. Another way that other cities have taken to diversify their revenue is through assessments. This is a proposal for you to consider directing. This is a directory resolution. It would be to direct staff and to hire Mark Lawson, who is present. Mark Lawson has a team. I've personally known Mark for many years, 30 years maybe. He has developed a system and has worked towards special assessments for fire. He represents Panama City Beach and the city of Springfield here in Bay County. And this resolution, if you choose to adopt it, would be to prepare notices for an assessment hearing on September 14th. And then if that assessment roll is adopted on September 14th, then on the tax bill that is sent, there would be a line item for fire assessments. And it appears on tax bills in Panama City Beach, in Springfield. There's also something like that in Bay County, unincorporated area. So I know Mr. McQueen, did you want to address this?
Thank you, Mr. Zimmerman. So as we were looking at this special assessment, we were looking at, as Mr. Zimmerman indicated, alternate revenue streams that could help to position the city's financial posture to be able to not only weather the storm of Hurricane Michael, but also to be able to withstand the uncertainties of the finances associated with the COVID-19. Obviously, we've seen a significant negative economic impact to our community as well as the state and the nation. These have also, the COVID-19 experience has also had an impact on the state's ability to project revenues. As of today, we still have not received our projected revenue certifications from the state, so we're operating quite honestly in the blind right now as we're developing, in the middle of developing the budget for next year. What we have looked at is also the fact that we're in recovery from Hurricane Michael. We know that we're going to have about $150 million worth of FEMA-funded projects on the horizon, and there's going to be the cost share of 12.5% that the city is going to have to finance to be able to support those projects as we rebuild the city. And it's, I believe it's critical that we look at alternative methods for raising funds through, and this methodology is the one that has come to mind. Since we do have sister communities that have had this in place for some time, it's a way that we believe that we can help shore up our fire department in the in our number one line of effort, which is safety and security for our citizens. This is one methodology that we have looked at that can help us to be able to shore up that that capability for our city. We were looking at this through last week, and in contact with our consultant, we realized we have just enough time to initiate the process for it to be effective for this upcoming tax year. I appreciate Mr. Lawson's advice and counsel and his expertise in this matter. And we've decided to bring this forward to you as we're developing the budget. We know this is a difficult time for all of our citizens. We know it's a difficult time for our city. And we're trying to find ways that can help to create a more equitable way to cover our fire assessment or our fire support to our citizens. In looking at this, we have over 2,000 approximately 2,000 properties in the city of Panama City that pay no ad valorem. And these are either homesteaded properties or nonprofit properties throughout the city, an evaluation of over $800 million worth of property that we're responsible for supporting, but we gain no ad valorem in being able to help offset our budgetary requirements. So as a result, the most equitable way to look at how do we support our fire requirements for our entire community was looking at the fire assessment methodology. So with that, I defer to you if this does move forward, if you know, with the rates that are being proposed. And again, there's no vote, no, there will be a public hearing on September 14th. Today's resolution is just to initiate the process to be able to have the discussion, to have the public hearing and the notices. The city is working closely with Mr. Lawson's team, and the property owners within the city will have access to a search tool that will be available online at the city's website that will allow them to search their address and to be able to see what the estimated assessment would be. And we'll have that online before the August 25th. And then we'll also be publishing notices and mailing them out in time for all the owners of our city, property owners of our city, to be able to know what we're they could expect. Again, this is in an aggregated situation. If this moved forward as presented, a vacant parcel of land would be responsible for approximately $176 of an annual payment. Again, paid for during their November tax assessment. And we started looking at what that would mean in terms of single-family residents. And the average single-family resident would pay approximately $279. Some would be more, some would be less, based on the value of that single-family residence. And again, it would be recommended that there would be a two-part calculation for that, where there would be a base rate for every parcel, of which there's about 17,000 parcels in the city of Panama City. And there would be a base rate for each parcel, and then a rate that would be for every $1,000 worth of certified improved value, certified by the property appraiser's office. And that would, together, that would meet the requirement to help us offset our financial requirements to support our fire department. It would generate, if the if this moved forward as recommended, it would generate nearly $4.7 million toward offsetting our fire department's expense, which is would meet about a 40% of the total budgeted amount that we're currently spending for our fire department. Certainly, I'd be happy to answer your questions. And we do have Mr. Lawson here, who is also available to talk about the process that would be employed if you so choose.
For the public's benefit, as well as our fellow commissioners, General McQueen threw a lot of numbers out there at everybody a few minutes ago. And so trying to put all that in perspective, one of the numbers that he threw out was over $800 million worth of property that is not paying any ad valorem tax, okay? Now, that is another number to kind of put that in perspective. That's 27% of the property in the city. So that's over a quarter of the property in the city that's not paying any property taxes that we still have to be responsible for the safety and security. So pretty significant amount of money and pretty significant amount of exposure. So this would help to not burden the people that are already paying all the property taxes, as well as they're going to be paying this assessment also, will help kind of spread that risk. So, just
another perspective. I agree with that. I totally agree with what you're saying. I understand.
Other discussions?
Yeah, I was blown away when I met with Jared yesterday with the fact that we generate, I'm just throwing approximate numbers out there, around $10 million from property ad valorem, and about $8 million probably from the merchant tax. So that means based in our budget for fire is around $8 million and our police is around $12 million. So just for safety and security, just for fire and safety, is that all the property ad valorems and the merchant tax we take in. Right?
Plus
2.3 of what?
No, there's an additional 2.3 million.
Oh, yeah. But I, wow. You know, I mean, that is a huge part of what the city does. And, you know, and you're right. I mean, if $800 million worth of property, and that's probably the property appraiser value, that may not, that's not even real, you know, market value. But you think about, I mean, that's a lot of property that we are still fully 100% responsible for, that the property ad valorems are, you know, that people who are paying their property taxes are doing. So it's just a, seems like such a more fair way to do it, and also leveraging another way to be able to help us during this time of getting hit by the hurricane and then by COVID. So, and it can only be used for fire. Correct. Right. So that's just interesting. That's just an interesting thought.
We, as this commission has been committed to our citizens time and again, particularly in our fire department, and as you know, about 3 months ago, we received our two fire trucks that we had purchased a year ago. And those, that was nearly $1 million for just the two trucks. As you also know, that we have two fire stations that we're going to need to build. One in near the Sweet Bay subdivision, moving fire station number 5, which is on Jackson Way, and move it over to Stanford Road. And the second one is to build a fire station up in Panama City North to support the development that's going on up there. So this is important for us to do, is, and I believe it's important for us to do this in order to set the foundation to establish safety and security for all of our citizens and to give them the level of service that they're expecting.
One benefit of having an assessment is that it can then be pledged to borrow money to buy a fire truck or to borrow money to build the fire station, so you don't have to save up cash, or you don't have to pledge the merchant tax or some other revenue source. So it's a revenue source that's dedicated to this. One thing that Mr. Lawson will do is that if this is implemented, then he will validate in court, just as he has for the city of Springfield, just as he has for Panama City Beach, a borrowing for a fire truck or something. And once the stream of revenues has been validated, a judge makes a finding that the assessment is lawful, it's indexed, there's an initial startup cost, but after that, there's an indexer that's built in, and the actual assessment cost, once it's going, is $30,000 plus some nominal cost. But so that is an additional benefit of having assessments, excuse me, is another source of revenue where you could use to borrow money to do these capital projects.
Other comment?
It's just fascinating. Tallahassee, I own some property over there, and even when I've had all the utilities cut off, like nothing's there, I still get a base bill that has a park fee, that has a stormwater fee, and a fire tax, basically tax assessment, whatever. Anyway, the point is that, but it's, I never thought about it till I got that, but till I bought a piece of property there, that it's still, everyone is benefits from those services. And so that, I'm not suggesting all of the above, but I just thought it was interesting that I think we're, you know, I don't know. But this is not to vote for it. This is just to move forward to see what the...
Here I go reminiscing again. I don't mean to take up time. Time is valuable. I don't know how many years ago it was. Commissioner Nichols, he spearheaded this at one time. And you know, you were right.
Sometimes
when
he's
when
right.
You did that, and that was not under this administration. That was not under this administration, you know. But you had the your thought process, the vision was hey, to fund everything we want to fund, we need to figure out how to offset some of it. And our number one priority has always been and always will be safety. Safety, fire and police. Police and fire. Safety, safety, safety. That's our number one priority. And so I want to applaud you. I remember when you talked to Jeff Brown. I remember that. And I do not know why, to this day, it never moved forward. You would know. I don't remember because, and I do meet with Jeff, you know. So I'm just saying, I want to give credit where credit's due. And I mean that. Nobody likes an assessment. Nobody likes that. Goodness gracious, I'm the first to admit it. But you know, folks, we've been bombarded. We all know that. We've been killed with Hurricane Michael and then COVID-19. And our revenue is down, and we have to borrow money, $75 million. And as the mayor said, we may have to go back to the well again. We probably will. But we want to provide the good service. And our goal and vision is to be the premier city in all of Northwest Florida. And I'm standing beside that. I'm standing behind Mr. McQueen on that. So that's my feelings. And I would like to, you know, we're not saying today we're passing. This is just a resolution. The vote would come on later down the road.
That's correct.
We'd be clear about that now.
It provides direction, a directory resolution. It gets the process started, authorizes notices to be sent. You'll be getting a lot of information before you get to September 14th.
Right.
Any other comments?
Thank you for letting me speak.
Mr. Mayor, one thing that I was looking at when I was going through all this, that Panama City seemed to be the last one to be implemented.
So, kind of like Mr. Rader was saying, we
heard about this many, many years ago. And, glad to see it's finally becoming to be almost enacted. There's a few more hurdles that we got to look at, and we'll have that done by the next September.
I'll just be quick. You know, just a lot of this that we talked about, and Mayor, you said it is that 25% of the properties are not paying any property tax out there, which is huge. And looking at this before is, and what we'll talk about later on in our agenda is our ad valorem rate, and then for me is how do we lower that rate? And so if we're looking at everyone sharing, because if there's a fire, they're going to come to every property if you're paying tax or not. And so this will balance that out. And two is how do we say, let's look at maybe lowering your ad valorem tax and applying this usage tax, if you want to call it that, to provide those services. And you said parks, and Commissioner, I know you love your parks, and citizens are using those. I know, but I mean, again, you see where cities have looked at those things and try to lower their ad valorem and say, hey, look, we're using parks. I pay the dollar. I've got, I think, 9 water bills. I pay that dollar every month. That extra dollar on each one of those bills. And so that's a voluntary thing. So, but I'd like to look at it and see. I don't think back years ago, thank you, Commissioner, is we just didn't have the research and back at that date to say, is it going to work? Can we do it? How do we implement it? So there's a lot of things that were going on in that period of time. But I'm glad we're looking at it now, and how does that fit in the agenda? And I'd like to hear from the citizens just kind of say, hey, we've got 25% of the people out there are not paying. So how do we bring that in? So
a lot.
Bunch. Okay. So hear a motion on resolution 2200728.3.
So moved. I'm sorry. Did you want to make that?
No, that's fine. Okay. Second.
Okay. Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes, ma'am.
Mayor, would it be fair to have, I know time is valuable, to Mr. Lawson speaking for a moment or not?
Yeah, come on up.
I know we came and you wanted to.
Mr.
If I didn't appear with a mask on, my secretary and my wife would shoot me.
Don't feel bad.
My
glasses fall good.
I'm pleased you gave direction. I do want to tell you that I've been doing this for decades, and we have spoken for at least 18 months about this. I have the wholehearted support of a fellow named Ken Small, who used to be the finance university teacher for the League of Cities. There are different methods out there. I actually developed one of the other significant ones years ago. But what we found is it doesn't work well, and it requires a lot of statistical manipulation. And I'm an old title insurance guy. I set up a title plant when I was 21 years old in Naples, and I understand the best property records in every community are that of the property appraiser. And then you take it a step further, the really good records are the ones they certify to the Department of Revenue. So what we've done is crafted a means to fairly share cost with Dr. Beitsch so that all parcels pay something, and then the remaining parcels pay in proportion to the improvements, not the land, just the improvements, to create equity. Your discussion about taxes is staggering, particularly when your revenues fall off. But please understand, and I want the public to understand this, that at the rates that are in your resolution, you'll only generate 40% of your fire budget. So for those people that we're trying to help, and we always must be respectful of nonprofits and modest homes and modest property owners, they're only going to be asked to pay 40% of the cost that is attributable to their property. The other 60 will still be paid by ad valorem taxes. Ad valorem taxes are the great equalizer. They're also the most inequitable means to raise revenue. So this is a more equitable means. The Supreme Court has since adopted this approach as meeting the legal requirements. My job as a lawyer is to gather a group of people together and to help your counsel and you do something that I do often that you all do once in a generation. And that is make sure it's legally sufficient, make sure it complies with the fair and reasonable standards that are required by law, help you do that and set up a method that is rinse and repeat year after year for less than a full-time employee. And more importantly, provide due process, notice and opportunity, but what is that? That is informing your citizens. So why am I here today? A lot of communities look at this and they will fall back and there'll be a lot of misperceptions. I think the reality is it's necessity. And so I appreciate a call last week. We don't have time to do this, do we? And I said, maybe, because there's a statutory process. You're going to have to send a mailed notice to everybody in the community and has to have certain information in it. And the reason this is happening is the printing deadlines to do the print stuff in mail takes time. We also have an expertise in that. So my job is to shepherd this for you so that you have good information for your community, good information for you, meet the process of due process, notice an opportunity to be heard, and then you can make a decision. You're going to, this may be the best of all the bad decisions, if you understand what I'm saying. It's difficult when you don't have enough money and you have to run a government. But I wanted to make the point that the assessment will still allow those that are otherwise tax exempt to only pay about 40% of those charges. You charge for water, you charge for sewer, you charge for garbage. The reality is this is an availability service that's expensive that everybody gets. I'm pleased that you've placed the confidence in your team and us. We'll do a good job for you, and I'll go back to the car and tell people to get to work.
And I would like to ask you one question,
yeah,
if it's okay. You know, you said 40%, right? And let's be clear, those 2,000 parcels of nonprofit churches or whatever, they're still not going to pay ad valorem. So that's
my point. It's
60%. Yeah, they don't.
It's like getting, so you we're not pay hitting for water double whammy. If you wanted to for everybody.
We're not doing double whammy.
Yeah. Right, no. Yeah. Now, but you do have to understand what happens here is by raising these funds, it takes the pressure off your general fund.
Right.
What is under attack here? Your merchant tax has gone down. Your general fund is under attack. Your state just told you they can't figure out how much money they're going to give you. You're getting it from all sides, folks. I'm a problem solver, but I also will help you do this respectfully and in a sensitive way and in a way that everybody has information.
Thank you,
sir.
Thank you
for the opportunity.
Appreciate you coming.
All right.
Good day. Mr. Mayor, I would like to read the resolution title. It's Resolution 20-272-8.3, a resolution of the City Commission of the City of Panama City, Florida, authorizing initiation of the process necessary for City Commission consideration of the imposition and collection of special assessments to fund in part the availability of fire protection services and facilities, providing for direction to comply with all necessary procedures and notice, and providing an effective date.
Is
Mr. Mayor and Commissioners, I draw your attention to the unfinished business in item 7A, which is the final reading of ordinance 2742.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for the property located at 836 East 25th Street. As background information, the applicant is requesting a land use change and rezoning to change the zoning from GC2 to MU3 in order to build apartments on the property at a future date. This item was reviewed by the Planning Board on June 8th, 2020, and the Planning Board recommended approval unanimously. The recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
This is like, go ahead.
I'd just like to go ahead and just recommend that for approval.
Okay. This is a public hearing. If anyone would like to address us on this issue, we have a motion on the floor. Here, second.
Second.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
Commission has adopted ordinance number 2742.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for a parcel of property located at 836 East 25th Street, Panama City, Florida, providing for repealer, severability, and effective date.
Item 7B is a final reading of ordinance 2742.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of mixed use 3, MU3, for the property located at 836 East 25th Street. It's the same information as I shared earlier in the future land use agenda request, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
This is continue the public hearing. Is there a motion on 2742.2?
Recommend approval. For amending the zoning map for the city of Panama City in that area.
Your second?
Second the motion, Mayor.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
Commission has adopted ordinance 2742.2 and ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 836 East 25th Street, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 0.909 acres, mixed use 3, providing for severability and effective date.
Item 7C is a final reading of ordinance 2743.1, a voluntary annexation of 2.971 acres of property located at 2803 Lisenby Avenue. The applicant has requested annexation into the city in order to utilize city services and to facilitate the development of a convenience store. The Planning Board considered this item on June 8th, 2020, and the request was approved unanimously. The recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the request for annexation.
This is a public hearing. Anyone want to address us on this? Hear a motion on ordinance 2743.1.
Move approval. Of 2743.1.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
Commission has adopted ordinance number 2743.1, an ordinance of the city approving the voluntary annexation of 2.971 acres of unincorporated property located at 2803 Lisenby Avenue, Bay County, Florida, into the city, as further defined here and after, amending the wards and boundaries of the city to include said land and providing an effective date.
Item 7D is the final reading of ordinance 2743.2, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of general commercial for the property located at 2803 Lisenby Avenue. It's the same information as I shared in the annexation agenda request, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
Continue the public hearing. Seeing no one, to hear a motion on ordinance 2743.2.
So yes. Moved.
Second.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
Commission has adopted ordinance number 2743.2, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of general commercial for a parcel of property located at 2803 Lisenby Avenue, Panama City, Florida, providing for repealer, severability, and effective date.
Item 7E is the final reading of Ordinance 2743.3, which is amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of General Commercial 2, GC2, for the property located at 2803 Lisenby Avenue. It's the same information as I shared in the annexation agenda request, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
Continuing the public hearing, anyone would want to address us on this issue? Seeing no one, do I hear a motion on 2743.3?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagas?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes.
Commission has adopted Ordinance 2743.3, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 2803 Lisenby Avenue, Panama City, having approximately 2.971 acres, GC2, providing for severability and effective date.
Item 7F is the final reading of Ordinance 2744.1, which is the voluntary annexation of 0.72 acres of property located at 1405 St. Andrews Boulevard. The applicant has requested annexation into the city in order to utilize city services and to facilitate the development of a convenience store. The Planning Board did consider this item on its June 8th, 2020 meeting, and the request was approved unanimously. The recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the request for annexation.
This is a public hearing. Anyone like to address us on this issue? Seeing no one, do I hear a motion on 2744.1?
Yes, Mayor, I'd like to move approval of Ordinance 2744.1 this morning.
Second the motion.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagas?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Abstain.
Item 7G.
The commission has adopted ordinance number, and I would like to note that the mayor has abstained to avoid even the appearance of an impropriety, even though there's no economic benefit that will be derived by the mayor. Ordinance number 2744.1, an ordinance of the city approving the voluntary annexation of 0.72 acres of unincorporated property located at 1405 St. Andrews Boulevard, Bay County, Florida, as further defined hereinafter, amending the wards and boundaries and to include said land, and an effective date.
Item 7G is the final reading of Ordinance 2744.2, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of general commercial for the property located at 1405 St. Andrews Boulevard. It's the same information as I previously shared in the annexation agenda request, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
We are still having a public hearing. Seeing no one to address us, we'll hear a motion on Ordinance 2744.2.
Move approval.
Second.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagas?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Abstain.
Same reasons. Ordinance number 2744.2, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of general commercial for a parcel of property located at 1405 St. Andrews Boulevard, providing for repealer, severability, and effective date.
Item 7H is the final reading of Ordinance 2744.3, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of General Commercial 2, GC2, for the property located at 1405 St. Andrews Boulevard. It's the same information as I shared in the annexation amendment agenda request, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
Still in the public hearing. Anyone want to address us on this issue? Seeing no one, do I hear a motion on Ordinance 2744.3?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagas?
Yep.
Mayor Bernicki?
Abstain.
Commission has adopted Ordinance number 2744.3, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 1405 St. Andrews Boulevard, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 0.72 acres, GC2, providing for severability and effective date.
Can I ask a question real quick before we go into Mr. McQueen's section? There will be some point in the near future that these maps be kind of updated with the six-laning of 390? Because I think right here you have these on current. Is this the four-lane or the two-lane right now? And then they'll be expanded because, again, that will show these properties a little differently. I guess we'll have that later. Yeah, 390 widening stuff. So when we look at these properties, that they're smaller parcels and why they're purchasing them.
Sure.
Okay.
So, Mr. Mayor and Commissioners, it's an opportunity to come forward with you to share a presentation concerning our Martin Theater, which, of course, is a landmark within the city of Panama City. As you know, Hurricane Michael created extensive damage to the entire community and certainly are one of our hallmark facilities within our community suffered great damage. In fact, it was nearly a total loss. In the aftermath of the storm, the insurance folks came to me and said, what do we want to do? Do we go ahead and just tear it down? And I said, absolutely not. It's an icon for our community and we need to preserve it. So with that, we embarked on a journey to determine how we could better utilize the Martin Theater to ensure that we secure the arts community as we have a great commitment to for the city of Panama City. With that, we've assembled a great body of citizens that have volunteered their time to help guide the process and help us to relook how the Martin Theater could be that icon in our community. We're very fortunate that the city had already acquired the building next door, which is commonly referred to as the DIB building, located at 413 Harrison Avenue. And this is an opportunity for us to, working through insurance, working with the vision of our great citizens, to look to see how we can bring those two buildings together to be able to better utilize that that site with the Martin Theater, and to make it more usable for our community with more than just a single purpose building. So with that, I would invite Kevin. As Kevin comes forward representing our great citizens, I want to acknowledge our quality of life director, Sean DePalma, and Dr. Kessia Milner, both on our staff, doing a great job working with our great citizens on trying to chart a new vision for the Martin Theater. With that, Kevin, I turn it over to you to share with the commission what the committee came up with.
Thank you all for the time. Thank you for inviting me to be on this group. Just on a personal matter before I jump into this, as like everybody here, I love this city. I love being a part of it. I work downtown. I work for ARA, so I'm right down the block there from that building. I'm also a property owner. I have a little rental in Millville on 4th and Elm Street, so I'm very vested in what happens in Panama City, and I've done plays in Martin as a kid, gone to see dozens of them. And so this did my heart good to be on this. And I think I speak for the whole committee. We all appreciate that. So I'll jump right in. So Mr. McQueen was very clear. He said, here's what we want you to do as a group. Here's what we want to accomplish. The first thing is to make the Martin and the DIB, and of course, when I reference the DIB from now on, we all know the building I'm talking about, the big orange building there attached to it, because we have big plans for that building also. So the DIB, make it multifunctional. We can no longer have it just do one thing, this whole facility. Second thing is to make it more self-sufficient. So it generates revenue. It makes money for itself as much as possible. Also to modernize this facility, because we have a great opportunity here. I really applaud the vision of this city and Mr. McQueen to look at that building, and when the insurance people go, hey, you should knock that down, to go, we just can't knock this thing down. You don't have downtown without this building. So now we have this blank slate. We have a big open box, and we can modernize this thing on the inside, but at the same time, keep the soul of the building, because that's everything, right? We all want to go down and have that Martin Theater experience. And so a modern facility with that sort of old soul that the building has. That was our job, and so we took that really seriously, and we came up with what we think is an outstanding plan for what this building can be in the future. So we set some priorities for the group internally. We said, okay, what do we want to see? What do we think will accomplish those goals that Mr. McQueen gave us? The first thing is seat count. We had Crook Stewart on this group, who is a a tour manager for people like Crosby, Stills, and Nash and the Rolling Stones. But he knows venues. He's been all over the world. He knows how to do this. And so he was great to say, hey, you need as much seat count as you can get. It helps lots of things. Second thing is foot traffic. We need people walking around downtown. Because when they do, as we know, when we go to these cities, we've all seen it, the cities who have this figured out. You go downtown, you're going to have a beer across the street, you want to go to the play over there, then you're going to walk down, maybe buy something in an art shop. It's a cumulative thing, so we just need people walking around downtown. What can the Martin do to bring them down there? Revenue options, I already mentioned that. This thing needs to make more money than just tickets for shows. And then flexibility. Along with revenue options, you need to be able to do more in this facility than just go to a play. You certainly need to be able to go to see a play. That's what we want, but there's got to be other things, and we have some options for that. And then more open hours. This thing needs to be open day and night, as much as possible through the week, and we have some specific recommendations that we think will accomplish that. This building is literally the beating heart of downtown, and if it's dark, it just automatically makes everything feel more dead. If it's awake, everything automatically feels more alive. And so that's what we want to see happen in this facility. Those were our priorities. So a quick thank you. Mr. McQueen already thanked Quality of Life, but I do want to thank Kessia, Dr. Milner, the freshly minted Dr. Milner, and also Sean for helping us with this, bringing us together. And then I really want to thank DAG. I think two guys from DAG. Two folks from DAG back there, we stretched them all manner of ways. We said, hey, show us this, give us that, make this map, change this thing, do that. And they just kept coming and giving us options. They were patient, but they also they were also very helpful to say, okay, let's set some limits on this because we started talking about like paint colors and light fixtures and stuff, and they go, look, hey, we're not there yet, let's back it up. So they were a really good rudder through this whole process. So let's jump into the building. First floor. What I'm going to do is show you overviews. I'm going to show you floor plans of each floor and go floor by floor and show you what we recommend and what we were thinking and just kind of walk you through it. I think we're all familiar enough with this building that you'll very quickly pick up where I am. So this is an overview of the Martin, but also the DIB. So at the top, that long thin space up there is the DIB building. The rest of it is the Martin. Green room at the bottom with all the chairs. So let's start in the lobby. We talked a lot about the lobby. What can we do with that thing? Can we make it bigger? That was because we all know that lobby is pretty cramped when you get a bunch of folks in there. The bottom line is no. For all the stuff that we wanted to do in the rest of the facility, DAG was really helpful to say, hey, yeah, you can move those bathrooms, but if you do, you're going to blow your budget. You're not going to be able to do fun stuff because you're going to be moving bathrooms. So we said, okay, we can't do that, but what can we do in there to make it feel a little bit bigger? Right now, in this center section, there are concessions. Mm-hmm. We recommend removing that because we're going to put concessions everywhere else in this building, all manner of places. And making that like a little, almost like a foyer, so the entrances would go into that space, and now you kind of have this open space when you walk in. People, they aren't standing in line right at the front as they move, you know, as people are coming in to get their tickets and that sort of thing. So that little change will help the lobby quite a lot. The other thing is, we, the group, consider the Martin and the DIB one facility now, one building. And so we recommend you knock a hole right there and put a doorway from the lobby of the Martin into the DIB building. That's going to serve a lot of purposes, which I'll explain as we go. But one of the things it does in relation to the lobby is now you can siphon people off of that lobby. So when you go in there to see a show or whatever and everybody's backed up, there's a place where people can go over there and you can make it an interesting space. It's going to have concessions over there. That will automatically pull people away from that front area. A nice big concession area, they can walk over there, it's gonna be beautiful. And now the lobby, it sort of moves people through that doorway. That's a very important pathway. The other thing is we can move ticket sales over there. Or the space up here at the top corner, facing, so it has a little bit of a storefront there facing Harrison Avenue, that can either be ticket sales where people can walk up or buy them inside, or that can be a gift shop, a merchandise shop. We wanna sell stuff. We want people to buy cool stuff. When they come downtown, I want that t-shirt or the hat. Or, you know, I've been to the Martin, like we do when we go to the Fox Theater in Atlanta, like we do when we go to other places. So that little space right there can generate revenue and also pull people away from the lobby, spread them out. The space where the ticket booth is right now, it can either stay the ticket booth or that can become a merchandise place. It's mix and match. So DAG said you can move these things around a little bit, but either way, expanding into the DIB gives us so many more options for the Martin itself. We thought at first, like, maybe we'll put rentals, like commercial rental space in there. Having folks on the board who know commercial rental, I know Alan Branch was there, he said, look, that building is a cave. Nobody's going to spend a lot of money on a cave for commercial rental. Let's make it part of the Martin and make it much more of a pleasant experience. So the green room, everybody knows the green room right there. We have plans for the green room. Currently, it has about, I think Barbara can tell me, 96, 98 people can fit in that thing, right? Capacity, something like that. 99 people. It's tight. We've all been in there. We've done events in there. So it's an important space for generating revenue. So we decided, okay, what can we do to stretch that building as much as possible? The first thing is, you know, the landscaping that runs along 4th Street right there, that goes away. So that space, we're taking that inside the walls, stretch the building out to the sidewalk. And then on the back over here, there's those steps that when you leave the Martin Theater, you walk up those steps currently. In that space, we can do steps, but you can also do a ramp system. But if we just do the ramp system, say we just get rid of the staircase and do a ramp system just like they do for the monorails at Disney World, you know, you walk up the big long ramps, you gain 6 feet on the back of the green room. So we recommend stretching the walls of the green room out as far as possible to up the capacity, anything we can do, every square inch, to either make revenue or get an extra body in there doing something fun instead of just stairs. So those are those two main spaces on the wings out there that we think have a lot of possibilities. Back to these doors. So we recommend that there's a door, that one in the lobby I mentioned, and then what that allows you to do is make another pathway down to the on the side of the theater and then put another doorway in so people can come in and out another side of the front of the theater. Because currently, if you've ever been in there with a small child, you're on that bottom row or whatever, and you're up on the, say, the right side of the theater. If you have to go to the bathroom, when your child has to go to the bathroom, we know it's going to happen in the middle of the show, right? Mm-hmm. You have to walk in front of the entire crowd to get out of that space.
Right.
So knock a door right there. And then you have another way for people to, one, enter the thing, but also exit. We've all done that sort of march down the current corridor. There's only one way in and out of the theater, and it's always crowded, and then you have folks on walkers, and you don't want to rush them, but there's lots of people. It's just crazy. So make this thing where people can get all the way around. Now you can get all the way around this theater space in lots of different ways, and it moves people around so much more, so much easier. And that way, and there's also going to be a little lift you'll see on the bottom one there, and that way people who need that, that's a good ADA sort of compliance type thing, just an accessibility item. But people will be able to get around this place so much easier. The theater itself. So, okay, what can we do with this theater? This is, again, we're having this particular group together was super duper helpful because we had people like Jason Hedden and we had Barb who know theater, right? And they could tell us, here's what you need for a successful theater show. But we also had Crook who said, here's what you need for a successful concert. Because we need to do more with this building. That's one of our goals, right? Was flexibility and revenue options. So you need different kinds of shows. And Crook said, look, if you want young people to come in here and do any kind of show, you need a flat space. Because right now we know the chairs are all on a rake. You need some flat space. They want to stand together and watch a show. He said, what happens if we make that space right in front flat? And we said, that's great for concerts. And then the theater people said, yeah, that's terrible for theater. Because you can't just, because then people are going to be sitting in a cave, right? They're going to be sitting flat. There's going to be concrete walls. However, the people at DAG and others said, you know, they make these sort of seats that are collapsible, that will go on a rake. And then when you want them for theater, you put them in there and you have your theater show. Then you collapse them, you drop them under the stage when you're about to have a concert, and you have a floor space right there. And so that's what we recommend. The other thing this will do is you can put a thrust stage out here now. Now you used to do stand-up comedy shows, and now you can do fashion shows, and now you can do all kinds of other little things in that space just by using that little middle space and making it flat. So we think that's a really neat flexibility option for this, for the inside of the theater. You can do so many more different things. So bottom floor, now that we have this broken up, another item that we were trying to do is make this as modular as possible. So every individual space in the building can be rented separately to make money, or you can rent them together.
So you can rent out the entire theater for whatever you want, and you have this cool space on the wings and the green room. You can just rent the DIB and the green room. You can rent one or the other. And this gives you lots of options for marketing this building for different kinds of events. So that's the first floor. I guess I'll stop right now. Any questions on the first floor before I know
not
I'm kind
questions,
of bulldozing
I got
through
a lot
this.
Of comments, but no questions. You're doing good.
A lot of comments.
You're
okay.
doing great.
Okay.
You're doing great, bro.
We'll save them up for the end. Second floor. We love the second floor. This group had a fun time with the second floor. So, okay, let's start up here. DIB building. This space is going to be super cool. It has a bar in it also for revenue options. This is your VIP lounge if you're going to have a concert, right? This is where you charge those. You double the ticket price. You send them up there. You give them a swanky drink. They get to meet the artist. That's a cool space. And there are some little, you can't see them here, but there'll probably be some little knockout windows facing the theater itself. So when you're up there having a cool event, you can look down into the theater. That'd be really neat. You have chairs, of course, off on the side, up in the top right corner. People can have conversations. You can do meet the artist events here. This can be rented out just as its own. It has restrooms in it, so it's a standalone facility all by itself. The second floor of the green room. Okay, so get ready for this. Second floor of the green room, we recommend you make that a rooftop bar / event space. Put a second floor on this thing and make it not totally open air, but you'll see the little collapsible kind of window things along the edge there. Make it so people can stand up there and look at this beautiful city and have a drink. That is a money maker right there. And those of us who have traveled a lot, we know that everywhere we go, we want to go to some rooftop bar and have a drink and look at the skyline. Okay, that's what we recommend happens here. It would have its own restrooms. It'll have its own warming kitchen. So if you want to do an event up there, and people want to cater it in, you have a warming kitchen. So now you have options for food as well as drinks up there. This, we think, is me personally, but also the group. This is what's going to make this building feel alive all the time. If you walk downtown and you see people standing up there having a good time, we even think down the road you could put a balcony out that would follow, that would basically cover the sidewalk on 4th Street. People can step out on the balcony. Oh my gosh, what a fun place to go, right? I'd pay $15 for a drink to go into that place. Now, you can connect these two spaces. Inside the building, there is going to be a walkway. This is not a balcony. I know it sort of looks like a balcony, but it's not. It's a walkway from both sides of that second floor. So if you had an event right here, you could have an outdoor space right there on the one side. You could have indoor space on the other side. You have a warming kitchen, you have bar, you have bathrooms on both sides, and you have the skyline view. That could make a cool event. These elevators, we put them strategically right there because now you can have people get off on any of the three floors. The DIB has a third floor, of course. But what this allows you to do is block these sections off. So now I don't have to have one side to have the other. And you can have events, you can have two separate events. You can have one on one side and one on the other going on at exactly the same time. They have their own facilities, they have their own spots. Those elevators are crucial to be right there. They let you section off the building. So now you can rent that side, you can rent this side, you can rent both of those. Or again, you can rent the entire building out for different kinds of events. We wanted to know, because currently right now you can't, of course, get on top of the building because there's no second floor on the green room. So we asked Aaron, Rich flew his drone over the building. We wanted to know, what's the view up there? What would it look like if you're standing in our proposed second floor bar? Well, it looks like this. If you're standing you're in that bar, imagine yourself looking at that, right? The lights at night, you have the bay, you can see either side, and then you turn around and you can walk right up and look at the heart of downtown, Harrison and 4th. And as this continues to develop, as whatever pavilion or whatever facilities happen down there, look at that mural. Look at that mural from that second floor. Oh my gosh. So you can see, come on, look at that, right? That's your view from that spot up there. To us and people who know this stuff in our group say, there's your revenue. That's big revenue. And it's consistent because that thing can stay open all the time. Can you tell we like the second floor? Yeah, okay. I wanted to make sure I made that point. third floor. The third floor, of course, is just the DIB space, but up here you have three studio spaces, kind of rental room spaces. In my work, in my day job, I do a lot of conferences, or I did before COVID, a lot of conferences around the country, and so I have been in lots and lots and lots of conference spaces. We all know you need some big, open, cool space to do a plenary session. Well, there's your, you have the theater. You need a space to do little breakout rooms and breakout meetings, and that's, we think these can be that. These could also be rented out for other purposes, but these are really good rooms. If you wanted to have AV equipment in there and projectors, you can do side meetings in there. It's just really good extra space. There are restrooms on that floor as well. And then we have another balcony. It's a small one, but it's on the third floor on the back of the DIB. It's open air. There's lots of things you can do with that. If you, as we know, those of us who go to conferences and do this stuff a lot, spaces like that are where business actually gets done, right? You do all your meetings, and then you go out and you have a drink, and you're sitting on the back balcony, and you have the actual conversations you went to the meeting to have. So we wanted to create those spaces around this building where people can go and, again, just look over the back. You'll look out the back there. You can see Moses, and you can see the bay from that third floor balcony. It's actually, of course, higher than where our rooftop one would be. So that's the third floor space and the use of that. So I guess that I know I've dumped a bunch on you. I wanted to be conscious of time. But let's review. Here was our job. This is what Mr. McQueen asked us to do, is to come up with an idea, come up with plans to make the building more multifunctional, to do more things than just theater, to make it more self-sufficient, revenue options, and then to modernize the inside of this facility, but keep the soul of the building. And our priorities were get as high a seat count as we can. The folks at DAG told us that right around 500, when you go over 500, your codes start to change for capacity. In other words, you start needing more exits, you start needing more stairs. It just starts to change the footprint of the building. And so we decided, how close can we get to 500 but stay just under? Right now, this plan, the current one, 480. That's not bad. That's very close.
That's an increase of 30 seats.
And this will increase by bar. What's the current capacity, or was?
It was 463.
463. Okay. So we're adding on 17 seats and keeping it right around 500. And we asked Crook. We all looked at Crook and said, Crook, would this sell concerts? And he said, that would sell concerts. You can do that. Foot traffic, revenue options, flexibility, and keeping that thing open. So that's what we did. And we're proud of this work. And we're honored to have been a part of it. We're excited about it. And I can't wait to have a drink on that rooftop bar. Any questions for me or Mr. McQueen or the rest of the group?
Hey, can I go first?
Go ahead.
First of all, man, you've got a great gift, buddy. You can sell.
Thank you.
You did a good job there. I echo everything you're saying about the seating. Crook, you know, him and I both, that's the first question any promoter is going to ask when they call from Nashville or New York City or anywhere, in Atlanta, how many seats you got? I love the idea of having a daytime come in gift shop. Tremendous. Awesome. You know, tremendous. Utilize the building. I love the idea of utilizing different sections of the building. Great vision. How affordable will it be in the end? We don't know.
Yeah. That wasn't our job.
That's going to be.
they said, come up with cool ideas, and that's what we did.
So you got the ideas, buddy. But how affordable will it be to rent also? Now, think about that. We can have a Taj Mahal, but if it's not affordable to rent, you know, we're shooting ourselves in the foot. So we got to, you all know that.
And I think one thing that the group, and others can speak to this who know more than I, but the idea was to possibly maybe have a management company who can target people who have the money to rent that facility, right? No, in other words, not just locals. We want locals to use this, but it didn't have to just be them.
And with that being said, I'm a little bit confused on the balcony because I've been in there hundred times and performed in there and rented the building myself, but I couldn't grasp the second floor.
It's just on 4th Street?
Well, that's because I'm not seeing it, you know, but that's okay.
Once you go down, when you stand on that sidewalk and just look straight up, imagine a balcony over
your
head.
I don't see how, I didn't see where it would be built inside. I couldn't.
Oh, gotcha.
I couldn't digest that.
Folks at DAG could draw anything.
Okay.
We found that out.
That's cool. But anyway, that's my thing, you know, the VIP area, great, the flat area. The biggest thing I've always had a problem with the Martin Theater from a, not just a renting aspect, but from an attending aspect, is those giant steps. Because I remember my dad, for example, when he got older, you know, he could hardly do it. You know, we preferred a slope floor, but I don't know if that's feasible.
That's not just feasible, it's law. So this correct? Oh. This building has to come up to ADA compliance. So am I correct?
So
the rake is going to change.
The steps will be gone?
I don't know they'll be gone, guys. I don't want to speak out of
turn. Well, I just,
but the slope is going to change. It has to.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Well, yeah. I think that's important. And I'm sorry I said too Agreed. Much, but because this is just the beginning. But man, it is so vitally important for our community.
Yep.
Thank you. Thank everybody on that board that has donated their time and their efforts, because my gosh, we need this.
It was fun.
Wow, that's a grand slam. Thank you, guys. I mean, it's a shame that we had to take a hurricane to get us to this point, and hopefully, I think with the insurance and what we have, we'll be able to accomplish what you guys came up with. But you are right, it is going to be a game changer for downtown. It is in the center right there. It's going to be phenomenal. One question, I know that you hit all the highlights and stuff. I knew in the past they had some issues with storage and storage costumes, and if they're having concerts, to bring in the equipment and stuff. So
backstage.
You left enough room for the backstage.
Yeah. Yeah, so, and Barb would know this better than anyone, of course. There is going to be storage back there. We spent most of our time on the customer-facing stuff, but storage is definitely, now there were a couple of ideas thrown out there, and again, I don't mean to speak out of turn, but possibly another facility, like a set building facility, like a building downtown that's separate from this where people can do that and store things and do things that would alleviate that, but we just ran out of time. We didn't, but okay. Storage is, Barb can speak to you about storage all day, and definitely is needed. Yeah.
All right, thank you.
Speechless. It's wonderful.
Thank you.
Everything I dream and hope and
gonna be
pray
great.
About.
Yep.
So yep. I think it's great. I did just want to roll, I really like the idea of retail being at the front of the DIB because it's a storefront. And but also love what we'd be selling in there. And then I think that was all. I just wanted to make sure. But it just, everything was like all the more that I ever could have thought for it. I mean, it's just amazing. I'm so excited.
Well, I don't know who made the list of people to be on this group, but they did a great job. I mean, it was just the right mix of people who had the right expertise, I think.
And Caitlin knew I was going to ask. She already texted me and said, you know, we're going to come up with a social media, you know, way to show it all on social media.
Yeah.
If there is a possibility of you doing a voiceover when you're doing that, okay. would be fantastic.
Yeah. All right.
Seriously, because it really does, like, explain a lot. Just looking at the pictures really doesn't help at all. But the way that you were able to do that, and I know Alan can hook you up with that and make sure that you're on to do the video. So, fantastic. Thank you.
Well, I'll hit... Let's go into history a little bit. That's probably me in that little corner right now. Yeah. Well, I remember when we had a balcony. I was here then.
Yeah,
yes, sir.
But it's a change, and I love it. And let's just keep going towards the future.
Let's do it.
And never go back.
Do it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, and I'm glad you mentioned that. So there's the balcony on the front of the Tennessee House, of course. That's Harrison Avenue. But right around the corner, we would put that the one on the green room. Yeah.
Thank you.
I got one more.
This is one of the bright spots of the hurricane.
Absolutely.
Because but for the fact that we had it well insured, we would have never been able to you know, we could have dreamed about this, but we couldn't do it.
That's right.
So
you're talking about the, you know, the hurricane hitting us, and we all know, but like Alan and I were talking the other day about, because he of course was building his brewery and stuff right in the middle of all that too, and you know, he said, look, entrepreneurs find a way. The entrepreneurs figure stuff out. You take whatever, and so an entrepreneurial city, which is, I know enough people in this city, it's starting to bubble. It just feels like this can be a literally a new chapter, and it was such a painful way to get there, but man, can it be great when we get on the other side. So
I have a question. I know this is premature, but did I hear you mention 4th Street coming out 6 feet from the green room? Possibility.
Now, on the 4th Street side, it's not a full 6 feet. It's okay. That landscaping that's down the front of the 4th Street side right now.
Okay.
So that would, and I forget exactly how many feet that is, but it's, that would go, that would be in the building. And then the 6 feet would be on the back of the green room. So right now, when you leave a show, you know, you come up those steps.
Yeah.
And it would, that wall would move toward those.
It's not going to affect the sidewalk.
Not at all. Okay. No. It'll come right up to the sidewalk.
Yeah.
But again, one of the things that we talked about was cities that are alive and feel alive, it's people seeing people. So if you can put that right up to the sidewalk and people can see their friends in the green room, whatever, it would be so much fun.
Awesome.
Okay. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Can I just leave this here?
Thank you, Kevin. I really appreciate that. Before we finish the Martin Theater presentation topic, I would like to acknowledge FMIT has done a brilliant job. As you know, the exterior of the building has been moving forward. We have been trying to do everything we could to restore the exterior to its original look. The EFIS has been completed. The vitrolite tile on the front has all been replaced and buffed, probably the first time that glass has ever been buffed in the history of that building. And the digital board that you approved, the marquee, is under construction and will be in place by mid-November. And so the exterior continues, and what we just had was a wonderful presentation. And this just proves when we have a citizen-driven process that we have an excellent outcome. I'd be remiss if I didn't acknowledge DAG. Owen and Chuck, if you would stand, please. And then also all of the members of this advisory group that spent their time on it, would you please rise so that we can acknowledge you and thank you so much. Thank you all. There's more to come. I do draw your attention to item 8B, which is consideration of the authorization for the mayor to execute a submerged lands lease with the state of Florida for the submerged cable serving the Frank Nelson Bridge, which is also known as the Tarpon Dock Bridge. As background, the easement, which is the submerged sovereign lands lease, is due for renewal for a subaqueous electrical cable which serves the bridge. On behalf of the Board of Trustees of the Internal Improvement Trust Fund of the State of Florida and Florida Department of Environmental Protection has prepared and signed the lease and is awaiting the city's execution of the lease to officially issue it. It will be a 50-year lease and there is no fee, and then the recommendation is that we do move forward on authorizing the mayor to sign the submerged land lease with the State of Florida.
Your motion on 8B.
Move approval.
Second the motion.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagos?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
So item 8C is the approval of the Bay City Point Phase 2 plat. As you know, on August 16th of 2019, the City of Panama City approved the development of Phase 2 of Bay City Point. The shopping center type development of 8 buildings located south of 23rd Street between Wilson Avenue and Highway 77. The Planning Board did consider this item on its July 13th, 2020 meeting, and all board members voted in favor of the motion to recommend approval of the request. This has been a tremendous asset to this community. It certainly drives the economic engine, enhances the economic engine of our community, and I just applaud what Bay City Point Phase 2 looks like as they're starting to open up a number of businesses. As a result, it's our recommendation that you move forward and approve the plat.
Your motion?
I make the motion, Mayor, to approve.
Second the motion.
Discussion?
Just a question real quick. Any plans for them to add sidewalks on the 77 side and the Wilson Avenue side?
I think there are on 77 already. Yeah,
yeah, just how far we're going to go down with them. But
the out parcels will have.
Okay.
The three out parcels on 77 will have sidewalks out.
So I know a lot of people are now traveling down Wilson to get there, taking shortcuts through or leaving that way. So we might want to look at sidewalks on Wilson Avenue.
Sure. Absolutely. Thank you.
That's my only question.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagos?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
So item 8D is the consideration of Tyndall Air Force Base, the F-35A and the MQ-9 Resolution 2020-0728.1. As you know, the President of the United States is committed to the rebuild of $4 billion of Tyndall Air Force Base. And with that, there's the concept of bringing forward, instead of the F-22s, to bring forward the squadrons of F-35s, and that EIS study is moving forward. Tyndall has done a brilliant job of soliciting citizen input to the process, and they hosted a virtual presentation on that just a couple of weeks ago. And that presentation is available at all of our public libraries for citizens to review. With that, there's also the decision that could be made to bring the MQ-9 Reapers also to Tyndall Air Force Base, bringing that, and it is in consideration with an opposing location over in California at one of the air bases there. With that, we feel very strongly as a city that Tyndall, which produces actually the DOD activity within Bay County, produces approximately 30% of the total revenues that are generated within our community. And with that, we think that we would be remiss in not providing public support to the efforts of the DOD and the consideration by the senior leadership of the military to determine the locations for the F-35s and the MQ-9s. And with that, I submit to you a recommendation that we have a public resolution that declares our unwavering support of the four squadrons of the F-35s to come to Tyndall Air Force Base, as well as the squadrons of MQ-9s that could come here as well. So with that, it's for your consideration for this resolution to be adopted.
Your motion on resolution 2200-728.1.
I'll move a motion.
I'll second it, Mayor.
Discussion. Call the roll.
I really don't want to talk because I really want to get out of my seat, but I just want to say that where I love this, because basically what we're doing is that we're agreeing that the city of Panama City will help to provide military members and their families access to quality schools. Just wanted to make a point of that, along with other stuff, medical care, employment opportunities, and other key quality of life and housing options. But I just think that's very interesting. That's how important it is to our military community.
Absolutely. Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
Commission has adopted resolution 2200-728.1, a resolution of the Commission of the City of Panama City, Florida, recognizing the commitment by the U.S. Air Force to rebuild Tyndall Air Force Base, Florida, as a next-generation installation supporting up to four squadrons of F-35 operational aircraft and an operational remotely piloted aircraft RPA wing with both a mission control element and a launch and recovery element with 24 aircraft.
Thank you very much. Item 8E is a consideration of the approval of a donation to Bay District Schools for the installation of shade sails at Jinks Middle School in the amount of $40,000. As background information, the Quality of Life Department is looking to support our schools within our city limits and enhance the quality of life of Panama City students and their educators. This $40,000 grant will be used toward the purchase of the shade sails for Jinks Middle School. This addition will enhance the outdoor leisure and the recreation capabilities for the students as the site lost its canopy during Hurricane Michael. Also, as you know, Hurricane Michael just totally destroyed their gymnasium, which is currently under construction, and our children have no shaded space on that campus for which they can go to. As a result, working with Dr. Milner as well as Ms. Carpenter, the principal of Jinks Middle School, she identified this as her most pressing concern, is to have a shaded space for her students. And with that, you can see this image that is before you that has the Jinks Middle School colors of green and yellow, and it's recommendation by us, by me and the quality of life staff to move forward with the grant of $40,000 to help offset the purchase of these shade sails for Jenks Middle School.
Your motion?
We'll move a motion to approve.
Second motion.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicki?
Yes. And we did get a thank you letter from Blythe, so from the school. So thank you so much, Principal.
And also, the school district is, I think the total cost is over 100. Oh, okay. Close to $200,000. This is a contribution we're doing, but they took it and made it bigger, which is going to be great for Jenks with tables and chairs and all kinds of things like that. So,
thank you very much. I draw your attention to item 8F, which is consideration of a proposed fiscal year 2021 millage rate for the city and the Downtown Improvement Board. With that, I would like to share with you that, as I discussed earlier, it's very uncertain times for our community with regard to building our budget for the next year. The staff has been working diligently on developing what their requirements are, but we are still uncertain as to what our allocations will be from the state with regard to a number of funding sources. The truth in millage or TRIM process informs taxpayers and the public about the legislative process by which local ad valorem or property taxes are determined. And we are required to inform the property appraiser of the following by August 2nd, 2020. First, we must submit to them what the prior year millage rate was. Second, we need to submit the current year proposed millage rate. Third, the current year rollback rate, and fourth, the date, time, and meeting place of the tentative budget hearings. For discussion purposes and for clarity, I would like to share a little bit about what some of the millage rate terms actually mean. So first is the current rate, which is the city's current millage rate for fiscal year 2020. The rollback rate is the rate that will generate approximately the same amount of revenue as the prior year. The adjusted rollback rate is the rate that would have been levied if the maximum vote rate for 2019 had been adopted. The majority rate is the rollback rate plus 3.22%, which is the adjustment for growth in per capita Florida personal income. The two-thirds rate is the maximum millage rate allowed at a 4 out of 5 vote by this commission. And then any rate above the two-thirds rate would require a unanimous vote of 5 out of 5, meaning if you wanted to go up to 10 mils. The table that's located before you lists the millage rate options for the fiscal year 2021. Today, you must levy any millage up to the constitutional or statutory maximum millage, which is up to 10 mils. The current year gross taxable value for operating purposes is $2,169,046,177. As we were building the budget, there were many things that we were considering. First is that the city is continuing to recover from Hurricane Michael in anticipation of our cost share at 12.5% of that total bill. Secondly, we looked at the uncertainty of revenues and the economic state because of COVID and state revenues and their certification of those allocations. Additionally, we're looking at the utilities and solid waste rate studies that this commission approved for consideration since it had been 5 years since the last rate study. Also, as you note, and there's been every one of you on the commission have been very staunch advocates of the census and the participation in the census. Right now, as we saw most recently, that the census count, we're behind the state average, and we're continuing to encourage our citizens to participate in the citizen or into the census. And because that census has a potential, as the mayor and I have spoke with the Department of Commerce last summer, that census could have a potential, that 4-hour named storm called Hurricane Michael could have a 10-year negative impact to the revenues of the state of Florida, as well as particularly to the city of Panama City. The city has also been in a position of decades of deferred investment in itself, both in its infrastructure and its operating fleet. And if we're trying to strive to become that premier city in the panhandle of Florida, as you know, we're focusing on the four lines of efforts, which are safety and security, as we spoke about earlier. In that, we're looking at the addition of body cams for our law enforcement officers. We've also talked earlier about a potential fire assessment. Secondly, we've looked at the infrastructure, and we talked a little bit about that earlier with regard to the rate studies that are underway. Third, we've already spoken about enhancing our economic activities of the city of Panama City and in support of that. And you just took action with a resolution in support of Tyndall Air Force Base as an example. And then fourth is our quality of life. And we just had a great presentation with regard to one dimension of the quality of life of this great city. With that, we're also building a budget that considers a cost of living adjustment for our city employees. As you know, the governor approved a 3% pay increase for all, a cost of living adjustment increase for all state employees at this time. With that, we continue to sharpen our pencils and continue to refine and determine how we can do things better and more cost effectively, and I'm committing that to you as our staff continues to revise the entire budgeting process for the city of Panama City as we embark on this new year of the 2020-2021 budget year. With that, I submit this for your consideration as to setting the maximum ceiling for what the millage rate would be. This is not committing to the millage rate for the next year. There will be more public hearings that will take place and will not be decided on until we have our meetings in September. We will have the first public hearing at our regularly scheduled meeting on the 8th of September at 5 p.m. right here in these chambers. And then the second meeting will take place on the Monday, the 21st of September at 5 p.m. Here in this chambers. With that, I submit this for your consideration and determination as to what the ceiling rate would be for the millage rate.
Commissioners, we have a lot of unknowns. We thought we had quite a few unknowns after the storm, and those unknowns were just the ones that were within the confines of our five-county area. And now, from making a determination of what kind of money that we're going to be or not going to be receiving in the future, normally we get these figures from the state in July, don't we? I mean, in May, okay? And we still don't have them. So, as Billy always says, every year when we do this, we can go back and lower it. So, we do need to make a determination at this particular time because we do have so many unknowns as to what number we need to put out there. I know the county did the maximum because they have so many unknowns. And so I know from our standpoint, what's the feeling of the commission?
I hate this time of the year. Yeah, this is the worst meeting.
Everybody does.
Yeah.
So just, you know, looking at the budget, I think we all had our meetings last week or this week and going through the budget. And yes, we've had a hurricane. And yes, we're going, unfortunately, through this COVID-19 that is affecting a lot of us. And a lot of people are not working. And some of those people are getting sick and have to stay at home and self-quarantine. Looking at these numbers and discussion I had with staff is, for me, I'm never going to go to 7.1, not even just to say, hey, we'll lower it in the future. I think our goal is to be at the rollback rate of 5.23 as a goal. That's what we should strive for. By saying that, I know we just approved the research of the fire assessment, which offsets that by several million dollars in that. So, you know, if we're looking at a number to set today because of the unknowns, I would go to the adjusted rollback rate to start with a number, and then with our ultimate goal is to get to the rollback rate if we get the fire assessment done. Just like everybody in our community, they're hurting, and we're going to have to look at saying, hey, we might need to hold on some projects until we get through it. I don't want to put the burden on our citizens. And two, if the county does apply their maximum rate, then that's just they're getting double hit. So that's just where I'm at in terms of the budget. I think the fire assessment is probably a good way, a good point to replace some of that. So with me, I'm not making a motion. I'm just throwing out my thought is what I'm looking at is adjusted rollback rate is a number to apply today and looking at it as we move forward.
Can I go next?
Sure.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Mayor. And you are correct. I always say that. We can come down. We all had our budget meetings, just like Commissioner Nichols said, and it was a lot of doom and gloom, a lot of unknowns. I always said it's the fear of the unknown that'll drive you crazy. Sometimes it will. We don't know the numbers from the state yet. We usually do by now. We always do by now. This is tough. This is tough. When I spoke with Jared yesterday, I know what the perfect picture for us would be to, you know, not perfect, but what they would like for us to do, I think, and I say that in respect, is the 7.5. I can't do that. I just can't in my heart today start that high. I'm close to you, Mike. I'm kind of looking at the 6.8333, that's the majority rate to start with, and I would like to bring it down below that. But and only because we do have the luxury of the possibility of the fire assessment fee. So, Mayor, if you want to speak, or Jenna, or somebody else, that's kind of how I feel. But I am willing to listen to other people.
Well, normally I usually stick with my 10%. I go to the max every time. but I'm always understanding, and I try to find a good leeway with the activities that we have got coming aboard now. And I think I can pretty well set with, let's try about a 6.2, and we can always come down later. But right now, I'm just waiting. I'm letting to the waves settle.
Which one are you picking?
I'll think about a 6.62.
Okay. Let me ask you a question before you speak. So downtown has a tax, a 3% tax on the businesses in that area, $3 million. And so my thought was that you can't go above 10. And so if we're at 7, you apply their 3 to it, that's 10. So you can't go, or is that separate then? I thought there was always a thing with the 3%.
So yes, sir. It's 10 statutorily for local governments. The DIB is an independent, dependent district of the city, so they can, you could technically levy a 10 mil rate for the city,
okay,
and they would still have an additional 3 mils in downtown.
Yeah, I thought there was some discussions years ago about 7. Okay, that was probably something else. Okay, sorry.
My goal this year is probably everybody else's, and especially with the fire assessment potential, is that we would lower our ad valorem, even if it's 5.4999, I mean, something less than what it is. So I don't think it's going to matter whether we do adjusted rollback right now or majority, because it's not, none of those I'm going to support anyway. So it really doesn't matter to me. Somebody just wants to pick one, we vote on it, move on. And then the real vote comes when we have to determine what the ad valorem is going to be. So I don't think we need to hash this out all night, all afternoon. But so whatever y'all want to do, it's fine with me. One of those.
All right, so I'm looking for a motion.
So I'll move that we apply the adjusted rollback rate of 6.6201 with our goal to lower it in September to a number that our citizens would appreciate. And hopefully our goal would be the 5.2385 with all the stuff that we're working on now.
Matt, I'll second the motion.
Okay. Discussion? I'd like to ask Jared or the general, with the shortfall of revenue, where would the, if we did not get the fire assessment, the 662, where would that put us with 600,000 less revenue?
Based on the current, I can't give you the exact number, but based on the current developed budget, we would be approximately $15 million short. We did not have a offset of a fire assessment.
And that's again, with reserves, but still.
It's not.
Yeah,
no.
She said yesterday it was with the reserves.
Zero without reserves. Okay. All right. Understanding all that.
What is your feeling, Mayor?
Well, you know, the difference between the 683 and the 662, it's one of those things that there's, I feel like we've got a very good chance to be able to be able to get the fire assessment done. And I would love to be a prognosticator to say, well, the state's going to come through for us at this particular level. And I have no idea.
Yeah.
They are so far behind right now with everything they're doing. I was arguing with them the other day just to get more COVID testing kits sent in here so that we could, you know, protect our people from that safety aspect. So I feel like that the difference between the 683 and the 662, I don't really think it really makes that much difference myself. I know that if we end up at those two particular rates and we don't get the fire assessment, you better tighten your belts.
Well, I think if we don't get the fire assessment, we're still going to have, no matter what, we're probably going to tighten it. Because the property ad valorems, I mean, they're great, but they're not, like he said earlier, they're not equitable. You know, they're not, it's just, it only covers
yeah.
a portion.
That's right.
And this
of
is
her operating. So
this is for 1 year. This is year.
So, I mean, so the question is just that because there's so many unknowns and you got to set some, I just don't, I personally don't see us voting for 6.83 ever, nor 7.5. And so I think if you know, I don't even see us doing a 6.6. So again, is if I don't see it and you feel the same, then that's the number we start with, and hopefully in the next week or so, the state will give us the numbers. We do the research on the fire assessment. We sharpen our pencil, and for a year, maybe there's some things that we don't work on, or purchase property or do other things for a year to get that balance until we get through this the stuff we're going through, and I just don't want to put that burden on our citizens.
Agreed.
Okay. There's a motion on the floor for 6.62. Your second?
He got a second.
Okay. Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
So also required at this meeting is to set the millage for the Downtown Improvement Board. The Downtown Improvement Board has done a great job of building their budget, and their budget has been built based on a 3 mil, which has been the historical rate that you just spoke of, Mr. Nichols. With that, the recommendation is to also approve a rate of 3 mil for the Downtown Improvement Board.
So I have a question about, I mean, same thing, right? We set it and then we can lower it or whatever. Because I would like to meet with the DIB. I think that it would be good for them to give us a presentation and like an update of what they've done last year and what they have planned for the upcoming year. Is that something y'all can do, Catherine? Okay. Anyway, that's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, and historically it's been 3%. So I move that it stays at 3% with the
Three mills.
Yeah, not 3%.
Okay, there a motion for three mills?
Yes.
A second?
I second the motion.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
And I was remiss not to mention that Ms. Waldron was on the line, ready to answer any of your questions. Obviously, she's been working very diligently on the budget, and I appreciate her her efforts, not only as dual-hatted as our budget director, but also as our acting city clerk. So thank you, Ms. Waldron.
Thank you, Brandy.
I do draw your attention to item 8G, which is the consideration of the approval of setting the date, the time, and the meeting place for the tentative budget hearing. Those would be as follows. It would be the 8th of September at 5:01 p.m. in these chambers here at the Bay County Government Center. Secondly, there would be the second public hearing would be on the 21st, Monday the 21st of September at 5:01 p.m. here at the Bay County Government Center in these chambers. With that, I'm making that recommendation to this board to be able to approve those dates, times, and meeting locations.
Your motion
so for moved.
The date and time of the budget hearing.
Yeah.
Yep. Second?
I'll second the motion for the 8th and the 21st.
Yes.
So Tuesday and Monday.
That's correct.
Yep.
Our regular meeting on the first Tuesday in September. And there, then it'll
the
be
meetings are 5:01 p.m.
At 5:01 p.m. Yes, sir.
Any other discussion? Yeah, that's our birthday,
our birthday,
isn't it?
Yay for us.
No, I'm old enough to be your daughter. Your husband, your father.
Somebody.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Mayor Bernicke?
Yes.
I draw your attention to item 8H, which is the Lindenwood Drive Improvements Community Meeting. I appreciate Commissioner Rader's leadership in this effort. As you know, the City of Panama City has secured a grant of $500,000 to help assist in, and that grant was from Florida DOT, to assist in redoing the paving in the Lindenwood Drive. That has been a project that has been underway for a number of years and quite frankly has been an abject failure of a number of reasons. With that, the City of Panama City is looking to hold a community meeting to discuss the redesign and the reconstruction of the Lindenwood Drive. The improvements will include new water lines and sewer lines, pavement, and drainage. It could have been a simple repaving job, but we would never have addressed the core problems, which were the water and sewer lines underneath it, as well as the stormwater drainage. With that, we're having a meeting Tuesday, August 4th at 6:15 p.m. here in these chambers of the Bay County Government Center located at 840 West 11th Street. Certainly, we'll be observing our social distancing practices, but if you have any questions with regard to this community meeting, you can certainly call our Public Works Department. They'd be happy to assist you with the drawings. We will have a complete dialogue with regard to it. The drawings for the improvements for that street, as well as the enhancements for that neighborhood.
Very good.
Yes.
Does the cemetery run by that road, one on the corner of 23rd Street and Lisenby?
Not at that location.
Not
it's close.
It's close, but it's not there.
Okay. The reason I brought that up, we need to work on that fence over there. It's been.
So the fence has been removed on that corner, and the we've installed or planted new vegetation there, and the plan is to go back with it. We just got that approved. The cemetery FEMA project was approved, and Mr. De Palma in our quality of life is working forward on how to improve the fencing that was along there. Another separate topic is very difficult to address, but it's with DOT concerning the sidewalk on the north edge of the Hillside Cemetery, and right now it's DOT had that stopped. They did not put in a sidewalk, and so now it's kind of a dirt path where people are walking within literally a foot or two of Highway 23rd, which is very a lot of traffic at high speed. So we're working that as a subsequent project.
Okay. And then just one last thing before we wrap it up is it possible to work on the broken telephone lines and the cables that are run between Frankfort Avenue and Beck Avenue? I'm not going to call AT&T out, but I think it's probably a lot of their poles and a lot of their lines that are, the new poles are up, and you've got, and it just looks really bad. I think I'd really clear their area up if we could reach out to them and ask them when they're going to accomplish that.
Absolutely. They could be AT&T poles. They could be Gulf Power poles, but there's a process, and we'll be glad to employ that. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, I hereby announce the commencement of the executive session. The estimated length is 30 minutes. Those attending are the five city commissioners, City Manager Mark McQueen, City Attorney Nevin Zimmerman, Attorney Cliff Higby, and Attorney Mike Burke. The conclusion, the commission will open, will reopen the commission meeting, so.
The session is upstairs.
It's going to be upstairs, so.
In the second floor conference room.
So we do that for 30 minutes and then come back for Destination Panama City? Poor Jennifer.
I'm going to adjourn the city commission meeting. And you're going to start the CDC meeting.